And I would like to refer to a mail I received last night from Mr. Stone, which has a very interesting footer.
Oh.
And in the footer, the lower part of the email, it says that whoever gets this mail has to be aware of the fact that NSA, the National Security Agency, is following it. Now my question is, would you have the same mail if you didn't make this film? The same text in your footer? Did you have it before you...
No, no, I put it on during the film.
Okay.
I don't know what you know of our Constitution, but the Fourth Amendment, the government's right to search and seizure has to have probable cause. Probable cause has to be shown very seriously by the government for them to invade your privacy, to go into your house, to go into your belongings, to tap your phones, anything like that. Probable cause is out the window, because now we're doing mass technology allows for mass eavesdropping, and everybody is in state. Everybody is at risk. It's not to say they read your email. No, it means to say that you have everything you say and do can be read by them, and that is a tremendous probability and a chance that I don't want to live under. I hate the idea that they can do that in the name of fighting terrorism originally. But now it's in the name pretty much, they do it for anything. It could be in the name of tax fraud, in the name of supposed illegalities. America has eroded that barrier that used to exist. It started really with a drug war kind of thing when they started to go after, there's something America called the RICO Amendment. The RICO Amendment allowed in the 19, Scarface dealt with that movie, Scarface in 1983. Dealt with the issue of the RICO Amendment, which allowed the government basically, if they were a supposed drug dealer, they could just move in, take your boat, take your house, take your property on suspicion, and then happened to quite a few people.
But there are kind of wars all the time. There's a drug war, and there is a war against terrorism, and then there was...
Some sound.
Yeah. Sorry.
Oh, you didn't hear me?
No.
Now it's okay? Guys, we need a bit louder. So I guess it's okay now?
No, not yet.
Not yet. Louder, please. Louder, louder. There were always different kinds of wars. Wars against something. Now it's terrorism. It was drugs. It was alcohol. It was whatever. It was the weapons of mass destruction. So. Of course, obviously, there are excuses. For what?
Aggression. Well, the United States likes the term war. We love that war. We call it War of the Apes now. We have the word war turns on the American spirit. And I think if you grow up on American movies from the 1940s on, you won't find that TV and film have a heavy emphasis on violence, and this goes way back, but it's gotten more and more violent. So the word war is popular. Politicians love it. It unites people behind you, and you make a war on gangs, a war on drugs, a war on terror, and it doesn't end. Unfortunately, the word has been misused, and it's part of that word language war that George Orwell talked about, the end of, you know, the verbiage that we use for rendition, or we use these words that are euphemisms for something horrible.
I have to say, I don't have to say it, but I will say it because I really, frankly, think it. I really like the film from the cinematic point of view. And since we will obviously talk much more about the issues and the theme of the film than the way it's made, could you tell us a bit how you prepare it in terms of dramaturgy, in terms of writing, in terms of shooting, and dealing with the director's job in this film?
Oh, God.
Separate
question. Gracious Christ. That was a, you know, listen, it starts small. It starts really with the Hong Kong scene, because that's where the story has to, we go back to Hong Kong 7 times. I believe.
Seven times.
It's a alternating story to the present. The reason the Hong Kong is put in is because it gives reference points. We're going back into the past, but we don't want to go into the whole story of all the years he spent in the NSA. So we cut to the Hong Kong room to get back to the present day action, and we go back into the past. And then we come to a merger in the end when we end up in Hong Kong, and it's real time, and he has to get out of there because they're closing in on him. Everything was pretty accurate, as far as I remember, to the day, to the way his story laid out. The concept was that he started small. It started in Geneva. This whole story of the banker is pretty accurate to the series of events that led him into a spiral where he realized that he was working for a government that was far more corrupt than when he started as a Boy Scout, let's face it. He was very much a Boy Scout from a small American town. His father and grandfather had been in service, and he felt strongly that he would do his part on the war on terror. On that basis, he went to he volunteered for Iraq, but his body was frail and his legs broke, and he shifted to the CIA. He was admitted. Strange story, but definitely admitted. And he got up very high, and then the CIA used him basically to go into he was moved to the NSA. And he worked as a contractor for the NSA. He was really trained as a CIA agent originally. And then he moved over to contractor positions, and he was working for the NSA. And in the NSA, he had tremendous access because he was very bright. He was one of those comers. He would have been, you know, a big shot if he'd stayed. But it was after Japan, he went to Japan. It became increasingly difficult for him after Japan to accept this situation. You saw what happened in Japan, the concept of malware, planting malware in allies such as Japan in their computers, putting malware in there, and basically it's holding that country hostage, essentially. You imagine what's going on in the world of computers is cyber warfare has taken over, cyber espionage and warfare. The American attack on Iran in 2010 was successful, or semi-successful, but it was a disaster actually because it alerted the world that the United States had developed the worm, the Stuxnet worm, and this worm was unstoppable. It was like a horror film creature. They couldn't kill it. It kept going. And kept going. I think there's still some variations on it today that exist. Elvis might be able, my assistant here, Elvis, who's a computer genius, you might be able to tell us a little bit about the Stuxnet worm. But this thing is sick, and it got into other countries' computers. And Israel and the United States planted it. They deny it. They completely deny it to this day. But Michael Hayden, who you saw a piece of, boasted about it pretty openly on 60 Minutes. We definitely screwed up the Iranian nuclear fission plants in Iran, but they were back online in 6 months. It took them 6 months to a year to get back online. So it was not effective in the end on stopping Iran. And to the contrary, it alerted the world that the United States had started a new form of warfare, in a sense. I discussed this with Mr. Putin. I said, it was like a Pearl Harbor. A new kind of warfare was declared in 2010, and the rest of the world woke up.
How many of you from the audience believe that there is a real Snowden in the movie? Raise the hand, please. Okay, can you tell us? The real Ed Snowden appears in the movie in one moment. Okay. Why did you decide to do it?
It's a natural dramatic instinct. I think you want to top it off, you know. Let's close the movie out. The guy exists. Remind people in the audience who don't know that the man does exist. This was not a made-up story. This is his version of it. So I think it hits home. The man is there. He's young. And he's been exiled, essentially, from the United States.
Now, I need a very frank answer. The ending of the film is a bit optimistic. It's to a certain extent with the kind of music you are using, even in heroic.
Well, it is a heroic action to me.
Yeah, so it's really giving us hope.
Yes, and he says that. He says, listen, there needs to be people, whistleblowers, journalists, you, people who care enough to come out and fight this kind of system.
I wanted to ask you.
Me.
Do you really believe in that?
I do.
You do?
I do. I believe in fighting. I don't believe you lie down and roll over and accept it, although we have to sometimes. No, I'm a fighter. Thank you. Nenad here is a professor. He's given up.
Sir.
You're a sir. A Croatian. You've seen too much history. You're cynical.
You know, Oliver, I tell you something. A director of one of the films I produced was killed because what he did.
Oh yeah, which was that?
So.
No, I'm saying, I'm aware of the dangers.
No, I'm just saying, at that level, we are quite close. Anyhow, when you say you believe in that, I believe that all of your work, especially your recent work, goes there. In different ways, in different genres. Now, how do you choose what are you going to do and how are you going to do it? For example, what would it take to make Putin a documentary, a fiction, and Snowden a documentary, if there was not a Snowden documentary?
Well, there was a Snowden
documentary. No, if there wasn't. Why you decide?
Well, actually, the Snowden documentary was about, he was one part of a three-part film. The truth was that the methods by which the things he learned was not in that documentary. You couldn't figure that out. This helped for me to understand the methods that the NSA was using. So I didn't finish my story until after Japan. Now, this is a key moment. He goes back to the U.S. He gives up, right? The girlfriend, Lindsay Mills, goes back. I can't take it anymore. He goes and he lives the life with Lindsay Mills in Maryland that he's supposed to live, the Richie. And he said this to us. He said, I had the perfect life. I was making more money than I ever dreamed of. I was one of the big shots. I could do what I wanted. I basically could sell. I was a CIA salesman. But he didn't feel good about it in some deep way. Then what happens is he has this epileptic attack, which nobody knew about until we raised it in the film. That was not in the documentary. The epileptic attack is a turning point, and it actually happened at that point in Maryland, where I don't know the causes of epilepsy, no one really does, but something gave in his conscience. His mother had been epileptic, but this was his first attack, and he was a serious one. And he had to either decide to cool out and be calm down his system, and Hawaii seemed to be the solution as a quieter way of life. But of course, Hawaii becomes a very interesting pivot point for him because he's asked to spy on China and Pakistan, actually. And it was at this point that he had more access up and down as a contractor, and laterally, he literally could penetrate various systems and steal them, copy them.
What I wanted to refer to is how do you choose? What are you going to do as a documentary or a
fiction? What does he choose? I think when does he choose it? And I think it's gradual. I don't think there's one moment. I don't think there's a one movie moment, so to speak. I think it is a gradual choice he arrived at, and it meant giving up his relationship with Lindsay, because he never told her anything anyway, right? It's a strange love story in there too, but as you know, she did join him in the end. I think that's the most interesting aspect of Lindsay, is that she joined him. She didn't have to. She could have gone off on her own and had another life. And I think she made the choice. As to me, I have no choice in this matter. Honestly, I would not have done Snowden. I was called to it in the sense that my German producer, Moritz Bormann, who's said, you have to do this. You can't turn it down. And I said, you know, I really don't want to get involved. This is going to be messy. If you deal with real life events that come up and they snap you in the ass, you know, maybe he turns out to be something else than he is. You may feel this is a tremendous amount of investment, and you don't want to get hurt, frankly, if you've been hurt a few times. So I said no, and he said, go to Moscow, meet, you know, see what it's like. And of course, that first meeting, it was interesting, and the second meeting, and after that. And by June, about 3 months later, I was in. And unfortunately, you know, it was, as I said earlier, it was a difficult process. I didn't enjoy it, for the most part. I learned a lot, but I didn't enjoy it.
Would you make fiction about Putin?
I was offered a good amount of money to make one right after I was doing it. I said, what's the point? I'm with a real man. I don't know that I'd want to make a fiction film. And I'm not a Russian. It's not in my blood. I don't understand the way people talk to each other, the way they're intimate with each other. I think it's better I stay away from that.
Since you are dealing with this nice and peaceful and sexy subjects, I understand that your next project is Guantanamo.
It's a little different. Let me just say, in terms of break, I've done 20 feature films, 7-8 documentaries, and I'm 70 years old, you know, so I like to have a sense. Films are very hard to make now. They've become increasingly, because people are watching small screens, and it seems the younger generation does not want to sit in a theater. I love the theater, but it's not really working. It's too difficult to make a picture with risk and make any kind of money with it. In fact, you're always at risk, and studios in America have completely left behind the drama. So it's just very difficult to make films unless you do them very, very cheaply. And sometimes you can't tell these kind of stories. So frankly, I don't know. I mean, I feel like television is the only way you can actually do something with some quality in it. And it, frankly, on television, I don't care as much about the image, because it doesn't mean the same thing.
But you love image. You're conceiving from
I think image is over for me, in sense of the image is beautiful when you see it on a screen like this. And I was watching some of that in the projection booth. There's some amazing photography here by Anthony Dodd-Battle, if you really pay attention. We use 65mm camera, which gave us this resolution that was very amazing. For a lot of these computer shots are much clearer to read when you have a 65, which you're blowing up into this 35 frames.
But also the way you've shot and edited.
Yeah,
the opening,
it's beautifully done. We care, we slaved.
Yeah.
But why?
There's not a single steady shot.
Well, if I did that for television, it'd be wasted.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yeah, but we saw it in the cinema, so we enjoy it in the cinema.
Well, I'm saying this is a problem. You know, Guantanamo, yeah, it's a wonderfully, it's an idea for a dramatic series. It was not my idea. It came to me from a writer, a very talented writer, Daniel Vole, and he came to me. He's known me for a long time, and I said, "Sure, let's give it a shot." We gave it a shot, and it's an interesting idea for a series with based on drama, based on truth, but not it is dramatized, and it would be a ten hour season. Each episode would be an hour. And I'm going to direct two of them. I'm going to supervise the writing room. We deal with 10 hours. You need 5 writers. It's a whole other way of doing movies. It's more of a committee. There's producers. It seems like everybody's involved. It's not the same thing as me making a movie where it's my responsibility. I don't feel the same way. That's not to say I'm not going to try, but it's just not the same thing. And the image doesn't matter on television. There's so much image as we have it. So many commercials are made using some of these techniques we used in the 80s and the 90s. Television has become, the image has become decadent. The image has become overused. I'm sick of imagery. It's almost like we have to go back to something that would respect the image. We have to respect the image, but it's impossible because it's been whored out so much. So I'm at a crossroads in a sense. I think, you know, I'll live on television if I can survive it for the next period and see what happens. Subject matter is good, but I just not excited as much as I am by making a movie.
But the way you did the series about Putin, shows that it's
not a movie. That's not a movie.
I know, but it's in your blood. You are using 3, 4, 5 cameras. you're cutting, you know, but between them, it has a very good rhythm. So I don't think you can go away from that. It's you.
Yeah. No, I would love to make a movie, but you know, they won't make the kind of movie I want to make, especially in America. Maybe I can get some financing out of Europe.
I'm sure here. Okay, as promised, now it's your turn. Folks, yeah, the gentleman, there's the first. In the middle. Just go here and, yeah.
Thank you for the movie and thank you being here with us. I have a question about facts. Can you tell us more about the facts? I mean, were there any facts or people or big events in the movie which are just fiction? And or maybe some facts that you received from Snowden but you didn't use, and why?
I thought you said sex, but you kept saying facts.
Well, there is a sex scene.
Well, here's a cinematic decision. We made it in the editing room. We had three or four scenes when he was stealing, copying. Don't use the word stealing, I mean copying. We had three or four, you know, at moments, because it was taking time. For the purposes of cinema, we went to one scene only, and we hyped it up a little bit with the supervisor in the other room having that problem, that meltdown on the 0 days issue. So you remember the combining the issue of this really happened. The United States was caught on a zero-day exploit in Syria, fucked it the whole country up. This was back in 2011, was it? You know, around 11, 12. So it was happening in real time. This is when we were really trying to screw Syria over. This is when the war starts, everything. So here we got caught, and shit was, I mean, it was a disaster. It was like the Iran mess, okay? Never got out. It's out there. It's a fact, but nobody really pays attention. And I thought that'd be a great diversionary tactic that's going on at the same time. In reality, he stole this, copied this stuff quietly, boringly. And you couldn't even know. You could be sitting right there doing it. You'd be sitting in the same room, nothing. You wouldn't even notice it. That's the way he did it. And how he got it out, he never told us, because I'm sure it was not a big deal. But he did suggest the idea of the disc.
The card.
I'm sorry. My mind is on Putin, and I just can't go back that far. But the card, the little card, was a very clever idea, and it seemed to. He's the one who suggested it because he knows that world, and he knows what he could get away with. So we built up the scene, but it was not at all dramatic when he took the stuff out of an office building. Actually, he worked in a tunnel, and then he worked later in an office building. So we took these are. These are the facts, and you can read about them. But that's the kind of thing we felt we could do. But the epileptic attack, I mean, I don't know exactly, you'd have to go ask me specifically, but most of these things happen. He had a relationship with Lindsay, he had an epileptic attack. He worked in these places. There was one issue, the NSA brought this up, and they tried to nail everything they could against us, but they said he would never have a meeting with the head of the deputy head of the NSA, which was shown at the hunting lodge, right? The hunting lodge. Yeah. But he had good contacts in Maryland at a higher level, so he would meet with top people. He may not have met with the deputy, but he certainly could have met the head of a department. There were several departments in the NSA, and he was working for one of them, technological department, and he could easily have met a deputy head. The whole idea of him having a mentor, Corbin O'Brien, played by Reese Affens, that idea is definitely not factual. He had a series of mentors along the way, people who saw him as smart and were helping him along, older men, or I don't know about a woman, but not a woman. But he had relationships, he was promoted, he was recommended. But we decided to put one person in because for movie purposes, it does simplify, like bringing 15 characters down to 3 characters. That's what movies do. You understand? But the NSA went after us for that, and they made a big point. But they really couldn't put holes in it because they had denied that Snowden had any importance ever. And the truth was that when we released the material, a lot came out about him, and we couldn't deny the story because he worked as a contractor at a high level.
Okay, the gentleman up there.
Those are some other things, of course, all the way along the line, but you'd have to remind me.
My question went in the same direction. I just wanted to ask you if the thing with the smuggling and the Rubik's Cube has been true or not.
The what?
The Rubik's Cube is not.
It was a Rubik's Cube. Yeah, you said the SIM card.
True detail or not. As to an example of, were the things he told you you were not able to use?
Well, he wouldn't tell us. No, he wouldn't tell us. He would not compromise. But, you know, what is there that really that we're trying to hide here? Think about it. He just basically told us by using this planning malware in Japanese infrastructure is pretty outrageous. Consider that. If they're doing it in Mexico or they're doing it in Brazil. I mean, you think out all the implications, and Europe, all the implications of this. If they're that advanced at that point in 2009, 10, my God, what can they not do? I think you should be asking that question. You see, the NSA is always denying, but allow your imagination to work. They say, we don't do this, we don't do that. Obama is such a liar. I mean, let's give him credit. He is a smooth liar. And I love that look at the end when he gets nailed. And what is he now? You know, Obama, smooth liar. This is what we make good presidents.
Okay.
You know what Lenin said about Woodrow Wilson? He called him a smoother over. Woodrow Wilson at the Peace of Versailles. A smoother over. I kind of like that expression. Well, certainly Obama is a smoother over. But he was caught with his pants down on this one, and he lied his way through it.
Okay.
Okay. If I could move from a smooth liar to a blatant liar, a question from Nick Holtz of the Hollywood Reporter. Do you have any comment on what's going on today, contemporary issues in America? Charlottesville, Trump's complete failure to respond adequately to that. The events you've portrayed in Snowden, I mean, they're coming home to roost now, really, aren't they?
Well, Nick, that's not a fair question, and you're not working. You're working for the Hollywood Reporter, and you should be dealing with movies. You're asking me something like the New York Times would ask me. I have no opinion.
My background's in hard news, not film news.
Well, he's Hollywood Reporter,
yeah,
so...
Yeah, we know.
I identified myself.
So I can't say anything, because they're going to quote me in Hollywood. You know, listen, I haven't been in the country. You know, I see the events. You're all trying to get to Trump every day. It's depressing to me. It seems like there's a much bigger problem. It's a system which existed before Trump. And as Mr. Putin said in the interview, he said this is the fourth president and nothing changes. Presidents say different things. They have big egos. We vote for the ego, but we miss the point. There is a deep state. There's an American foreign policy that continues in the same direction. There's a military industrial security state that is inexorable and won't stop spending money and increasing their budgets. Trump, by increasing their budget, has shocked us all because at one point he did seem like a bit of a reformer when he said that he would concentrate on building up the infrastructure of America. But he didn't do that. He cut significantly into that infrastructure, and he's also added to the military budget. So he's another one to me in a line of presidents. But you know, you in the press, you love to single him out. But I think you missed the point.
It's not really about Trump.
You missed the point about the system.
No, it's about Charlottesville and what's
that system continues through Trump, Obama, Bush. Bush started a whole thing with his eavesdropping that has reached beyond horror show. It's the system that has to be corrected, and that takes work, and it's never as exciting as talking about some lunatic president.
Okay, the lady here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Matteo Valentinčić from TV Slovenia. Last week I saw your interviews with Putin, which I found them very interesting, like a kind of, let's say, political science documentary. But my question would be, would you comment on negative criticism of your interviews with Putin in America, especially in American media?
Well, I thought we were subject here with Snowden. We can talk about the same thing about Snowden. you know, what the American media has a bone to pick. They've been picking that bone for a long time. My films have been, even back when I started, were heavily criticized, and I think over the years that has been consistent. Every film I've done has been a mixed, quote, mixed reaction, so it's not a comfortable feeling, and it's harder and harder to work there. That's really my comment.
Okay, next one. No, it's good.
But I can retreat to TV and join a committee, and I won't be dangerous. How can I be so dangerous if I'm with 20 other people making a TV series?
So already Mike there?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm wondering what Edward Snowden doing now. He's now in Russia, and we learned something from him. I don't know why is he so silent now. We don't have any real contact with him. Maybe you know something, and you can share with us.
You know, I am surprised. I mean, Ed has been quiet on the Russian meddling with the election story. And obviously he's in a sensitive position because he would like to return to the United States, correct? And he's made that point, but it doesn't seem likely with Obama not pardoning him. And that went by, and now Mr. Trump has been much more negative. In fact, the CIA chief, Pompeo, said that Snowden and Assange were major targets of our intelligence agency. So it seems that the being quiet doesn't work. I think I've heard that he's relaxed more about life. He's coming out more. He's being more social. He's traveling around more. I think Lindsay has made a huge difference. Lindsay Mills has gone over there. So let's hope for the best for him. But he's been very quiet on the front where Julian Assange has really been out there and fighting. Julian Assange has been central to this argument that people don't understand. And he has brought out this Vault 7, all these tradecraft possibilities that are available to the CIA. He's tried to explain to us what the CIA can do. And I don't think people get it because the dialogue on the news level is so stupid in the United States still about this Russia intervention in the election. It defies common sense. I mean, I don't want to go into it, but basically, we're talking about Snowden here, but it ties into Snowden because it's about the whole concept of this computer warfare, computer espionage, which is misunderstood.
Maybe Snowden's preparing to become a professor.
I wish he would.
The lady there.
I wish he would, yeah. About cyber espionage,
yeah.
Because he's very good at it.
Yeah.
I'm Hajar Sinanovic, and I'm in front of our Heart Film program, and I'd like to congratulate you on this beautiful movie and including it for this. And my question would be, do you think global society is headed towards an image of Orwell's 1984, which you mentioned earlier, and that painting of society, how relevant that piece of fiction is today?
What was the last sentence? I'm sorry.
How relevant that piece of fiction
1984. Listen, I read 1984 recently when I was working on the script. 1984 is here. It's past. This is we are there. The only thing that they haven't quite done is erased the history yet. There are people who still remember things.
If you live in this part of the world, I don't know if you
agree. Is that right? I don't know.
Erasing,
I think
our history every day.
But. No, I do. I don't. I think Orwell was very correct, and he predicted it. But other people did too, and I think we're way past it. I think what's happening now is that you can make anything up. It seems in virtual world and sell it to the people, as the United States has done with this viral warfare against Russia. Against China, Iran, whatever they want. North Korea next.
Hello, Mr. Strong. I have one question. I'm a young filmmaker, and I want you to give me some advice for young filmmakers. Do you see any bright future for the movies and young filmmakers?
Well, you're operating in another. You, first of all, there's no expectations against you, so this is important. You, they don't know who you are. They're not going to label you. But certainly, if you work at a low level, where you can low budget level, you can do. You can make some exciting things. It's up to you. It's up to your imagination. No one. The technology is cheaper than ever. You can make a film without much spending much. And when I was young, it was much more expensive and harder because we only had film. We didn't even have video. Video contact with film. Yeah, one second. I want to just go back for 1 second, just a reminder. But do you remember the scene in 1984 when the Hate Week, the last one, the Hate Week, and they changed the enemy in the middle of the rally? I think it Oceania becomes Asiana or something like that, and they changed the face of the leader to Hate.
Yeah,
and that was a wonderful moment, and it reminds me so much of what we're going through. Because 1 week it's terrorism, the next week it's Putin, next week it's Korea. You know, it doesn't change that mentality, but they're actually doing it and getting away with it constantly, constantly. American media is disgusting. The Time Magazine approach, the NBC, ABC, the television, whatever you see on television, they believe. It's unbelievable to me that people can be so rooted into the image. And this is what I talked about, the decadence of the image. It means nothing. Image is a lie. And until we rediscover the meaning and the real essence of an image, we're violating. We're in contempt. And it's really depressing me. Yeah, I guess so. A young filmmaker here, trying to make films. Yeah. Try to find the image and make it real to you.
Mr. Stone.
Yeah, the gentleman here.
You talked a little bit about Assange. I was wondering if you might say a word about the difference between Snowden, Assange, and Chelsea Manning, maybe? Okay, maybe you don't want to do that. But can I ask you a second question? They interviewed Julian Assange when Trump was not even a candidate, yes? And he said, he didn't use the word deep state as you used yesterday, but he said, they will never allow him to be president. I wondered if you had an observation on that.
Was that he said that before? Yeah. Well, Julian, I respect very much. It's been very accurate. But they allowed him.
Yeah,
and we'll see. We'll see what happens. Ultimately, I don't know that it's an issue that matters because whether he finishes his term or not, that system is in place. Elections come and go. They don't mean anything anymore. They haven't meant anything since Kennedy got killed. I know that people make a big deal about me and that thing, but it really has changed a lot, and the presidents don't mean anything. If the president tries to stop this military-industrial complex, gonna have a hell of a hard time doing it.
Yeah.
Why do you think there's not more talk in America about the surveillance state, even after films and the media coverage of Snowden? And then as a follow-up, have you done anything personally differently about your own privacy because you're now more aware of the different forms of surveillance?
Well, because they always put another thing in front of you. I mean, wasn't it surveillance a huge issue about 2 years ago? And then when did Russia become an issue again, as if Russia were the greatest threat to peace in the world? What issue are they going to put before us again? I mean, the next terrorist attack, I presume that will be an issue again. So in other words, they keep... They shift the attention of the public constantly. And we don't seem to have the ability to grade stories and have different levels. It just seems that we present one mass image. And that's very 1984.
Please keep it short.
There's a Spanish songwriter, Sabina, that said, "Why is it so easy to be a coward and so difficult to be a hero?" Countries like Portugal are creating invisible faces. Spain has the Mareas. Which countries that were spied on, including Japan and others, are creating a system to reward thinking or reward risk-taking?
That's a good
which
question.
Which groups are protecting privacy and civil rights? As a group that you know that exists, or governments that are promoting thinking and respect?
Thank you.
That's it. I can't answer that. I mean, I would anger too many people. I think the systems exist. I mean, I think that the computer generation has tremendous knowledge and intelligence, and yet we have the stupidest foreign policy we've ever had. So it doesn't correlate necessarily that intelligence in America correlate with what we actually do. And if we end up fighting another war, which is quite likely, it seems that we're suicidal. Maybe, you know, China is not in a solution for me, but perhaps for other people. But it certainly is. I've not been able to get anything through the Chinese wall. Anything has ever been approved. It's always been censored. And that's for years. Every subject matter in China, censored.
Okay, the lady.
Hello. I would like to ask shortly, this movie seems to me a little bit like a science fiction, just because it's like very terrifying what NSA does to us. And it's really that I think that, do you think that the audience really understands what's happening in the movie? Like, politically, what's happening behind the curtains? Because we are still using the social media and still exposing ourselves, and which is, they can keep tracking us, which is against the human rights.
Can you explain that?
To her, it looks more like a science fiction. And what is your point of can we still go on with, you know, privacy in terms of using social media and so on? So, what is the way out?
You're asking me very tough questions. I don't know. It seems like privacy, the younger generation doesn't mind. It seems. Privacy is gone. It's not going to be here. Snowden said that it's over in terms of having privacy. But then, you know, we're all living in that world, that Jim Carrey movie. What was the name of that movie? Truman Show?
Yeah.
Perhaps that's it. I don't have a solution. That's why I'm an older man. Maybe the younger generation can find a way to revolt and tear it down.
Okay. Where is the mic?
Hello, Yona Pavlova from Festivalist. I would like to bring the conversation a little bit back to the film.
Yeah.
And I was thinking that your film is based first on your own footage with Snowden, then with on the Lauer portrait documentary, then also a little bit on the 90s cyberpunk aesthetics.
The 90s
cyberpunk.
The cyberpunk aesthetics of the movies from the 90s. And then I was also thinking about the grand narrative of America that you also tackle very often in your movies. So I was wondering how about your aesthetic choices, about the visuals, about how did you combine all these stories into one? Thank you.
Yeah.
Another tough question.
Yeah, the documentary was the basis of which the story is framed in that document. Her presence brings it to a head. But the insides of the NSA, we tried to conform to as close as possible to naturalism, because Snowden gave us exact sketches of where these things were and gave us as much as possible the dialogue. Well, I have notes of him correcting our dialogue with exact, nobody in the NSA would say such a thing and say this and this, and he'd rewrite it. So we tried to be as realistic as possible with the NSA material. He doesn't have much of a private life, actually. And he's a very quiet person. The photography by Anthony Dodd Mantle, as I said, we tried to emphasize the resolutions, trying to give as much clarity as possible to very obscure the computer work is excellent, by the way. I have to point out we had a team of German technicians, very, very good, out of Munich and Berlin, and they really went over the charts that they had. Anything that Snowden gave us, and it was all purloined. It was material that, you know, was not supposed to be in the public eye, but we did have access to the NSA charts. So I'm surprised at some of the film critics in America who said that this was outdated, sort of a dated film. But yeah, NSA did not have big money that way. They were spending, they had very cheap settings. So we had to match the settings. That's what we were trying to do. We didn't want to give it a science fiction feeling at all. We didn't want to pretend that it was not happening. So that's why it's a rather, in my opinion, low gloss 1984 look, which is to say old fashioned in a way, but that's what they, the way they are. They work that way. What they're doing is certainly modern. The way they're doing it is cheap fluorescent lighting, the worst kind of lighting in the NSA, and stuff like that. One more thing, the CIA classes very accurately mimicked what Snowden told us about the tests, how they did them. So I don't know what we did wrong, but you know, I think what we're trying to do is be accurate, because it's a responsibility to make a film like that, and that's part of the reason I'm telling you I didn't enjoy it as much, because it was a responsibility. And when you do something like that, you have, it's important, and you try to do it as accurately as possible, although sometimes you just like to let it go and fly, you know, fly away.
Yes?
Hello, my name is Asma. I'm a Palestinian-Jordanian film director, and my question is, earlier you said that it wasn't well received and praised in the US, although I've been watching The House of Cards and addicted to House of Cards, which also doesn't praise the US, and I felt that it doesn't give a good image or bright image about the US, but why is it well received, and why is your film isn't? That's one question. And the second, please, if you can tell us about the drafts, the script writing phase, and how many drafts you had, like tips on the script writing.
Script writing was painful. I would say 8, 9, 10 drafts. Snowden participated, would make notes. For example, he would say things like, let's forget that, because I don't want to get into that issue, I'm sorry. But he would certainly weigh in, and we'd go back and we'd talk to him. But on the issue of House of Cards, you know, I've watched it a bit, so I'm not an expert. And it's very successful, yes. And it does give people an emotional involvement in a miserable character. And it's interesting that it's successful, because a few years ago, I'm not sure it would have been. It would have been too cynical. But I think the public is burned out and cynical. And I think they like the evil, the way Kevin Spacey plays it. I find it to be a wholly cynical thing. I would never do that, because I don't believe the characters are that bad, you see. The system is different. The system is evil, the way it makes people tear each other apart. But I don't believe that this man, played by Spacey, could be successful in America, in reality. You see what I'm saying? I do think you have to have, you have to play an American game to be successful. But the series is, and it's sad. It's sad that America has reached that place where presidents murder each other and so forth. I never said Lyndon Johnson killed John Kennedy. I told you he benefited from it, and he certainly covered up the investigation. But I never suggested in the film that Johnson initiated a desire to kill Kennedy, although Kennedy was going to replace him as the vice president.
Yeah.
Hi. It doesn't surprise me that there's a large constituency in the US that might not have liked the film, but it does surprise me that you struggled to find anyone really to help fund it.
Yeah.
Why do you think that is? Was it a fear element, or is it that they genuinely felt that...
well, you could say, you know, the way they say it, they never say it that way. They always say, well, it's not commercial. Or they'll say you know, and a lot of the critics said the documentary got made, we understand the whole story, we don't need to see more. Well, that's bullshit. Anybody who sees a documentary knows that it's a story unto itself, and that there's a lot more material in this film about that case, and you don't know it. And the fact is that they bury it. That's what critics do. When something important comes up, they dismiss it. We've seen it before. Bullshit, you haven't seen it before. That's what I really think is... It's why do people do that? Why? I mean, I've seen it happen to so many films. You know, they get destroyed in their essence. It was, you know, I think our Rotten Tomatoes, whatever that is, it was so low. It was ridiculous. Why? the documentary satisfied some people, but it didn't see, you know, $3 million it made. You know, it's not the same audience. We are a worldwide audience to show this. And we frankly did better business overall in Europe. So I think the audience is to some degree, but I do think there is an issue in the movie, yes. In my heart, I knew it when I made it. It's too hard, it's too cold. There's a coldness in the movie, and that's one of the reasons I have to say, you know, I can see where it misses to some degree. It doesn't have that emotional connection to an audience that's unique. The actor is cold, and deliberately so. That was his choice. Snowden is not a warm fish. His girlfriend is far warmer than he is. So I see the problems inherent in the material. It's also not a love story that warms you up. You know, it's not Last of the Mohicans or you know what I'm saying? It doesn't have that kind of lift. So I see those problems and I accept it. I accept the box office. It's a shame because it was so difficult to make. The US did come in, by the way, after Europe came in. Open Road, which is a small company and now out of business, but they did come in and they did put not a lot of money, but enough to get the distribution rights, and it fucked us up because the truth was that we were so, the Cannes Festival really wanted to show this in May of last year, and that's really where we belonged. We knew it because it was a film that was financed out of Europe. The Europeans were much more open to Snowden than the Americans were, percentage-wise. So we should have been at Cannes. But the American distributor, when they got their deal, had the exclusive right to open. And they said, no, we don't want anything to do with Cannes. We want to come out in September in the United States. So we lost the Cannes date. And I think that would have been the whole difference. And I think we would have done much better in Europe. And then fuck the United States. If it did shown in Europe first, piracy's out there now. I'm not worried about piracy like I used to be. Let it show in France and Germany and Italy and so forth. And then bring it out in the United States in September. It would have worked. It probably would have worked better.
Two more questions, one here and sorry, one there. I'm sorry, guys, that's...
What?
Sorry?
I'm trying for an hour.
I know.
Oh, yeah, 1 hour, 1 hour.
Okay, one question.
Sir?
Yes?
I have a Bishop. Short question. Yeah, so in the film, there's a scene where he's having a first audition for CIA, and he's been asked for his influences, Snowden, and he mentions Joseph Campbell. Is it true, and how do you think that Joseph Campbell really inspired his actions?
Oh yeah, definitely, that was one of his reference points. Again, I'm saying we worked very closely with Ed. We wouldn't have put in something like that if he hadn't said it. He said it somewhere else too.
The lady who is waiting for an hour.
Hello. I'm a filmmaker.
I just want to say, I'll get back to you, but I just want to say the reason it's in is because he was influenced by Campbell's book, and he drew for us a map of the way he saw his life, because it changed from being this patriot to being this arch villain. And he drew the map of the myth of how you have to go through hell, basically, to find yourself. That was the Joe Campbell story from.
Yeah.
Hello, I'm a filmmaker from Turkey based in New York, and I have to say that as a fan of Platoon and YouTube Bone Killer and Scarface, I have a love and hate relationship with you. Like, which is very love and hate.
Love and hate relationship with you.
Today was not a day of hate, I want to say that.
That was, she was waiting for an hour.
I will tell you. Joseph Gordon-Levitt once said that in an interview that you're a very truthful patriot, in a way that you would risk to be maybe labeled as traitor to serve.
I don't understand.
Patriot.
That you are very good. She was told that you were a good patriot, but maybe later labeled a traitor. Okay. Continue.
And I think maybe today. I felt like you were beyond being a patriot, maybe more global. And I feel, I want to ask this question. How did your opinions change throughout the interviews? Did you change your perspective? Did you change your perspective while doing interviews?
With?
About the position of United States and the rest of the world.
The interviews with who?
With Snowden and maybe Putin. Yeah.
Did you change your opinion during the interviews you had with Snowden or Putin in terms of your relation towards America?
No, I think if you look at the work, it's been growing. It's growing, and I did something called The Untold History of the United States. I worked 5 years on it. It goes from 1880s to 2013. It's a lot of work. It was done with a historian. Very factual, very interesting series. And you see where you can see the points of view that are coming into being. So I've grown with my knowledge from Snowden of computers, and my knowledge from Mr. Putin of the geopolitical balance. Yes, it grows, but definitely moving in the same direction since Salvador in 1985-86. Salvador was, for me, a very confirming. See, I had been in Vietnam, and I had seen the behavior of a country and a power that was a bully in a situation that killed a lot of people, and I had seen it with my own eyes, but it's hard to sometimes wake up, especially if you're in shock. But I would think when I went back to Central America and I saw the American policy towards Nicaragua, especially from Mr. Reagan's point of view, that they were communists and that we were fighting communism in Salvador, Honduras, Guatemala, and Nicaragua. And when you go to those countries and you see what we were doing, you have to understand that this was no joke. This was Vietnam over again, Redux. And I've seen it too much. So this is an old attitude from 1985 that's been growing and growing and growing.
The last question, the young lady. So.
Oh, hi, Mr. Stone. You said you didn't enjoy filming this because of the huge responsibility. Yet, I might be mistaken, but you seem to quite enjoy the Putin interviews.
Well, they were much easier to make.
Which some would say also came with a huge responsibility. Was the difference?
Well, there was a huge responsibility, but I'm not. The words are coming from his mouth too, you know. So it's a different ball game. It's, you know, with Snowden, it was not only the issues of trying to be authentic to Mr. Snowden's experience, which I felt a responsibility, but also the difficulty of making it without enough money, always not knowing if we could finish, and constant pressure, constant adaptation to compromises. And I did them, but I think we did them well. I think the film works, but I suffered for it, and I slaved over it. The editing took almost a year. I've been in very tough films too. This is not the first one, but this one was, for some reason, maybe it's my age, but I feel like I got beaten up. And when the film came out, and I think we made the mistake, as I said, of bringing it out in the United States. I think it was a huge mistake. And I just feel, you know, you always think you're gonna win when you get beaten so much, you know, you feel like Putin was right.
I think
and then the Putin interviews after it, I feel like, you know, I feel like I've been fucking knocked for a loop, all right?
I think that's a great ending. Tomorrow, a platoon and another Q&A.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.